Hello everyone, welcome to Less Code, More Power. We have an amazing episode all on application lifecycle management, and that is all about solutions. If you're aware of the Dataverse or Dataverse for Teams, you're going to learn all about how to create and export and import solutions. So stay tuned. Hello everyone, welcome back to Less Code, More Power. I'm Sarah and my co-host is...
Donna, hello.
Woo, hey, and we're so excited. We've been wanting to do this show for so long and we finally pinned down Phil and Marc, like literally, to say, we need you to come on the show and talk to our audience around ALM. So welcome to the show, Phil and Marc.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, no problem. It's our pleasure. So could you just briefly just kind of give us the elevator pitch of who you are, what you do, and why ALM is awesome?
Phil, why don't you go first?
Yeah, so my name is Phil Topness. I work at Microsoft on the PowerCat team. It's the Power Apps Customer Advisory team. So if there's a large global deployment of Power Apps or Power Platform, we're involved in it in one way or another. And a big part of that is application lifecycle management. So for these large deployments, how do you reliably control your app and manage the development that's getting done on it and move it to a test environment or to a prod environment or to one of many other environments? So in short, that's what we're gonna be talking about today.
And I'm Marc Schweigert. I'm also on PowerCat. And I've been doing ALM with Power Platform since before it was Power Platform. And so looking forward to having this conversation.
Brilliant. You know, I do have to say, I do love the matching PowerCat shirts. I like how I can't point at both of you at once.
It's so embarrassing, Donna. We did not plan this at all.
Yeah, I know. Like, I do love the matching PowerCat shirts. That's kind of adorable. Yeah.
I think it is planning. I reckon it feels like they planned more than we do, Donna.
You know, and for someone in the fashion industry to compliment us, I mean, that's pretty good.
Well, yeah,
I get that all the time.
Make sure I was wearing this shirt. So. He actually asked me what I was wearing, which I thought was awkward. But
so, in terms of ALM, guys, so one of the things I really want to make sure our audience know right now is ALM isn't just for if you're doing Power Apps, right? Like, and also if you've been working in this industry even for like over 10 years, ALM, mm-hmm. like it's evolving, right? Like it's changing. There's investments in this arena, so. Phil, I know that you're going to be showing us a lot of the stuff in our first part. So this is part one, and it's going to really show our audience an overview of ALM and kind of explain from the ground up what it is. And then, Marc, you're taking the lead on the second part of the series to really see how you can make ALM easier. So do you want to take it away, Phil?
Yeah, the way I think about ALM, and here's like how I categorize it in my mind. So, and we've all done this. You put your app, you give it to a tester, the tester goes to work and they find a bug. And
hey, Phil, can you tell everyone what ALM is before you start?
Explaining? Sure, yeah. So, yeah. So ALM is application lifecycle management. It's how do you maintain and manage all of the work that's being done on your app from when it's created and all the developers that are collaborating on it. And then as it moves through the test process and through production, and then continually gets updated from over the span of its life, right? Its entire life cycle.
Awesome.
That's a great definition. Yeah.
Sorry, I like rudely interrupted you. You were like, so you give your work to your tester.
Yeah. So you give it to your tester finds a bug, you go back to your desk, you try to find the same bug, and you start writing an email with those five words that each of us have typed. It works on my machine, right?
Yep.
That's what we're trying to fix.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Or like another way it shows up is you it takes so long to deploy your app to test or deploy it to prod that you wait. And so yes. You've got functionality that your tester hasn't seen or worse that you don't have in production, right? So like there's this tweet I like to refer to that if you on the screen here, if you look, this is how one of our peers at Microsoft talks about or thinks that the deployment process looks like, right? This has 6,000 retweets, 22,000 likes. Right? If this is what your app deployment process looks like, that's a problem, right? You have functionality that you are holding back and not giving to your tester or worse, mm-hmm. not to your users, right?
So it's that last bit. I can't do that last bit, that flip that they do. Well, I'm screwed.
Wait, okay, so this is importing the solution. Wait for it. Stick the landing.
Whoa. Right.
So this is a common enough problem that, you know, people believe this is, you know, what the deployment process looks like. And so we're going to talk today about, like, how do you manage that from a manual perspective, from an automation perspective? And then Mark is going to talk about how do we put a layer on top of this that makes it easier for everyone to do.
Brilliant. That sounds amazing. I think we've all felt that happiness that that person in that video, yes, like, kind of was showing when we've successfully, like, deployed something.
Right? Yeah.
Yes. We're like fingers, toes, elbows crossed. Yes. Like, just, oh, yeah.
You know, I think one of the things that's interesting about ALM in the context of Power Platform too, and I think in general with ALM, is that if you don't need it, like, don't use it, right? But right. I think most people realize they need it once they start experiencing what, you know, Phil just showed in that video, right? There comes a point where you start to feel like you need something more than what you're currently doing with what you're building. And that's kind of how we think about ALM with Power Platform, is that it really is intended to be able to support everything from, like, enterprise grade pro dev ALM all the way down to citizen developer building a bunch of stuff, putting it in something and moving it from one environment to another. And if you think about it, that's a hard challenge to meet both ends of that spectrum. And so hopefully we'll show some things that help people realize that ALM is maybe a little bit more approachable than they think it is.
Mark, that's such an amazing point. Phil, before you dive into the depth, Mark, could you like tell our audience, like, kind of, could you explain to them that ALM isn't something you just choose to do when it gets to that point, right? Like, kind of, there are different versions of ALM, like you said, like, kind of, like, skimmed down version, but you can't just implement it when it suddenly becomes a nightmare, right?
That's right, because if you get to that point, then you've got a lot of work to do to get to a place where your ALM processes are healthy, right? And so understanding ALM up front, understanding sort of when it makes sense to introduce ALM in your low code development, I think is really helpful to try to understand, because then you can set yourself up for success much earlier on.
Yeah, perfect.
And I had a customer just last week. He built a Power Virtual Agent. Now, you know, total citizen developer. He's like, I built this bot. Our call center is going to use this to answer their questions, but I need to move it to another environment. How do I do it, right? And solutions are the answer, right? It's even for someone that has never touched Power Platform before, built their first bot. It's easy to do.
And I would say we want to encourage people to start looking at solutions and hopefully feeling that solutions aren't as scary as maybe some people think they are. Because the more you're embracing solutions now, the better off you'll be in the future as your applications become more complex.
Definitely. Absolutely. Totally.
Love it.
Brilliant. Phil, show us the way.
Show us something. Show us.
So on my screen here, I've got an app that I've been building for this. It's my Cap the Cat app. What it does is it allows us to imagine Sarah in different types of headgear or hairstyles.
Cap the Cat.
I know. This is amazing.
It was almost Dress the Donna, and then I decided Cap the Cat was probably a better word.
That's probably better. Yeah.
Yeah. But I built this without solutions in mind. And now I realize that this probably, you know, has a potential millions of users, right? So I need to move it into a different environment. So let's put it in a solution. So here back, you know, in the maker area, I click on solutions and I can create a new solution. And really we're talking about solutions, but solutions are really just kind of a folder to put everything that you can do in the platform. So I'll do Cap the Cat, give it a publisher, and create.
I think that's going to be my new Twitter handle. I think I might change that. Cat. Cat. Yeah.
It's a good handle. I like this. Wow. Okay. Yeah.
So here in this solution now, I can add pretty much anything I can do in Power Platform. Mm-hmm. So let's add in that app that I created, Cap the Cat. And then now it's in a solution. And so I can export it and easily move it between environments. I've got another app that's a little more complex if you want to see that, that shows kind of some of more of the capabilities. It's also cat themed because that's how we roll here. This is Catfisher. And what it does is it loads an image of a cat. It allows you to name it, rate it.
Love it. Love it. Yeah.
And then it stores them all in Dataverse, the images and all that.
I love that.
That loading wheel is amazing.
Is that a loading wheel? Oh my God. Yeah.
So yeah, we can make this available. So these images, just so you know, too, this is actually where the biggest time suck is here. They're all AI generated. they're AI generated images of cats. Here is AI generated images of humans. This, I could spend an hour hitting F5 on this page. I mean, this is, oh, that's, my gosh, that person doesn't exist. It's an AI, right? So crazy.
That's amazing.
It's amazing.
So what this app does is it basically saves you the time of hitting refresh on this cat does not exist.
Donna's just dying. I think you had Donna at the first app. Now the second app, she's just like,
I want that cat wheel thing because I'm putting that in every app from now on. And people are like, what is that? And we're like, mm-hmm, you're welcome. So while they're waiting, they can be entertained.
Donna, would you like to name this guy here? Do you want to actually be a user remotely?
Oh my gosh. We should call him Monster.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I know. Everyone else is like fluffy kins. I'm like Monster. Yeah.
Monster.
I think I do have a fair number of fluffy kins and tests in here.
I have a lot of fluffy kins, but like Monster.
And then some AI puddle mistakes in here too, right? Like this one, it's like, wow.
Oh, wow. No, there's one called No,
yeah.
This is so awesome. This so you're storing in Dataverse. That's so cool. So you made a solution, Dataverse backed, and now you can move it anywhere.
Now I can export it and move it, right. Yeah. And I think what you just brought up, Don, is an important part here, right? Mm-hmm. Is I've also got a Dataverse table in here. So it's not just about moving your app, it's about moving your schema and the relationships from dev to test to prod, which is, you know, pretty easy to do here and less easy to do in other ways. I've also got it in an environment variable, because when a cat gets rated 5 stars, it sends out a kittygram email. Aww. And so this allows me to send it to a QA address in my QA environment, a production address, right, in my production environment.
A 5-star well cat.
5-star cat, yeah, for notable five-star cats.
Notable cats, oh my gosh.
I've got a model-driven app, so I can maintain all the data. Security role, because I've got a custom table, I need to put security on. So this is like everything you would need for a functional app. And when you need to move it, publish changes, and that makes sure that everything that you've been working on gets pushed out to the solution you're about to create. And then click next once it's done, and we'll create a solution file, which is really just a zip file of all the configurations. So I'll hit export, and in a moment, it's going to download the solution file, and I can move it into my test environment.
That's awesome.
I love it.
So here in my test environment, if you want to see, I'll import that there. And this is how I would deploy then that app to test. I can go browse for the solution file, which again is just a zip file full of the configurations. And you'll see, because I was using connection references, they allow me to connect it differently in dev, test, and prod. And so when I hit next, it allow me to connect to Dataverse and to mail using connections that are specific to my test environment in this case, and then import it. And that'll connect up my flow to those connection references. And for Canvas apps, I still need to connect them in, but it's mostly deployed to test at that point.
So Phil, I know that we don't want to go too deep in the complexities of solutions. We'll probably do like another video on that in the future. Mm-hmm. But could you just briefly explain the difference to the audience on unmanaged and managed solutions?
Yeah, the short way to think about it is unmanaged solutions are like source code. So you'd really only use that in your development environment when you're working. Managed solutions are for test or production environments. And one of the most important differences between these is an unmanaged solution, when you delete that solution, all of the underlying components stay in your environment. But for a managed solution, when you delete it, it's fully removed. So like for a test environment, you'd want to be able to fully remove one version maybe and then bring in another version. Managed solutions allow you to do that.
Brilliant.
Oh, very cool. I did not know about unmanaged solutions. That's new information for me.
Well, that's a good thing. Actually, don't even think about unmanaged solutions, Donna. Yeah. Think about managed solutions.
Exactly. I'm like, why would I do unmanaged solutions? No, I wouldn't.
That's why it's the default.
Yeah. Okay.
This is epic. This is so cool. So we're at that time in the show. So thank you so much for showing us like kind of, it's almost like the ALM 101, right? So Phil, what's your homework for this part one of the series? Mm-hmm. So for everyone that's watching, we do have part two. So like if you're watching this, either if you're watching this live as it's being released, it's going to be a week in the future. If you're not, then go ahead and click it straight away. So Mark's going to really show you the process that Phil just did and show you how to automate that. But for right now, Phil, what would be your homework for those people that are maybe just learning how to use solutions or maybe haven't been comfortable with solutions in the past?
Yeah, so I've got some links up on the screen. The first one is just the overall Power Platform ALM homepage, which has links into resources about solutions as well as automation. And then you can automate each one of these in Azure DevOps and with GitHub Actions. And there are hands-on labs that you can use to learn that and go through how to basically go through the same process you just saw me do manually, but have Azure DevOps do it for you or have GitHub do it for you, both exporting, putting it into source control, which is something that you can't do manually, and then deploying it. So these links will take you to those labs.
Those are actually great. I've actually done them myself as well. So those are such great links. So I can't recommend them enough. Mm-hmm. Brilliant. This is amazing. Well, thank you. Thank you so much for your time. Yeah, this is great.
And thank you for teaching us this. This is fantastic. I'm absolutely going to create a solution and export it, because right now my method is so sketchy. It's like stored on a share, link to it. Like maybe you'll get all the stuff, including the database tables. No, I don't think so. This is fantastic. Thank you so much.
There's a better way, Donna.
There's a better way. And I just learned it. My team's going to be really happy rather than my sketchy means. So thank you. Thank you so much for being here. I can't wait till next time to hear Marc spiel on advanced ALM. All right, folks, we'll see you next time. Till then, less code.
More power.